Assalamu alaikum everyone, I hope you guys are doing well. Today we are going to talk about the difference between gender studies and women's studies. And I think it's very important to mention here that women's studies is an older term than gender studies. It actually came before gender studies. Therefore, it would be better if we begin our talk with women's studies first. Now the question is, how did women's studies originate as a discipline? What happened? What were the conditions that led to the development of this academic discipline? Well, till the late 1960s, various disciplines like the social sciences and sociology did not acknowledge women as an important gender. They completely ignored the interests of women, the experiences of women, their contributions, their issues, even their identity. And at that time, the gender discrimination and gender inequality was not a matter of concern for those disciplines. Therefore, we can say that sociology and the social sciences of the time was from a man's perspective, in which women were always portrayed in the limited roles of a mother or as a wife. Even the contributions of women in English literature and other academic fields were completely ignored and neglected. The influential people of the time who were present in the academia, they had excluded women writers altogether. And all of these disciplines were very gender blind. They were from a very limited perspective of men. So now I think it's the right time to introduce you guys to a new word called androcentrism. Alright, androcentrism is the practice of placing a masculine point of view. A masculine point of view at the center of one's worldview. That of course influences culture, history and society altogether. It refers to a male-centered worldview, which positions men and boys as the representatives of the human condition or experience. So androcentrism exists in all the fields of study, and the cultural expressions, the disciplines, arts, sciences, medicine. And this is what was happening at the time as well. In the fields of sociology and social sciences, the influential people who were responsible for the creation of knowledge at that time, they had completely ignored the issues of women. They had completely ignored the issues of gender inequality, gender discrimination, the contributions of women. And these were the circumstances which led to the development of women's studies as a separate academic discipline. Now, since women were already at a disadvantaged position, they were disadvantaged in the political arena, they were not represented there, the economic roles of women were suffering from inequalities, women was financially she was financially suffering, and even the academic disciplines at that time, as we just talked about, they were ignoring women, they were ignoring their issues, they were ignoring their contributions. So that was the time in the 1960s when women gathered in the form of feminist activists. During the second wave of feminism, they raised their voices in protest, conscious raising groups, rallies, petitions, newsletters, unofficial and experimental classes and presentations, and every other available platform. And as a result, a number of disciplines across the social sciences, sociology, arts and humanities, they began to pay attention to women and their role, their experiences, their issues, their contributions, etc. Especially the women sociologists, they started to focus on the issues of gender inequality and gender discrimination, and various disciplines started to fill the gaps in knowledge about women, the gaps that were left due to the male bias. Alright, okay, now what is meant by male bias? It simply means favoring man as a gender, favoring man as opposed to woman. Alright, I know this is a lot to remember, these are a lot of new terminologies that we are discussing in our very first lectures, but trust me, inshallah, as the time passes, we will eventually be able to get hold of all of these terminologies and concepts, inshallah. Alright, okay, where was I? Yeah, various disciplines started to fill the gaps in knowledge about women, alright, the gaps that were left due to male bias. And that was the time when women's studies emerged as a discipline. In the 1970s, although the first course on women's studies had already started in 1969 in the Cornell University. At some sources I found that the University of Kansas to be the first one to begin a course on women's studies in the 1960s. Anyways, many young students, many young teachers, community members created the ad hoc committee for women's studies. So we can conclude that the courses had already begun in the 1960s, and then in the 1970s, the first programs in women's studies began in San Diego University and Sunny Buffalo in the US. Okay, now this was the time in the 1970s when women's studies was flourishing. It was expanding. Various programs, various undergraduate and graduate programs, courses on women's studies were being offered in different colleges, different universities. So women's studies began to flourish during this time. It was expanding. The first scholarly journal on women's studies, called the Feminist Studies, began to publish in 1972, and then was the first MA offered by the University of Kent in 1980, followed by other masters and undergraduate degrees elsewhere around the globe. And then later in the 1990s, PhD was also offered in various universities. And to be more specific, the Emory University was the first one to establish a PhD program in women's studies in 1990. Though it all began in the US and UK respectively, but now there are various universities all around the world that are offering many programs, including PhD in women's studies. And I think it's also important to note that many women's studies courses contained a conscious raising component. Okay, it means the experience and identities of the students themselves determine the dynamics of the classroom. Conscious raising refers to the process or an activity intended to make people more aware of political or personal or social issues. It's a process of achieving greater awareness of one's own needs, alright? And it's also important to note that women's studies is an interdisciplinary subject. It has strong roots based on sociology, English and history. And when we use the term interdisciplinary for any subject, it means that it is relating to more than one branch of knowledge. Or in simple words, you can say that it draws its knowledge from several other fields like sociology, anthropology, psychology, etc. So women's studies is interdisciplinary in nature, and so is gender studies, but we will get to it in a while. Now, because during this time, women as a concept continued to expand, alright, and the people had actually begun to study and explore the idea of gender as a social construct. Alright, so this led to the expansion of this field from women's studies to gender studies, and it also brought attention towards the sexuality studies. Though initially, women's studies emerged out of feminist activism, but in the process it recognized how gender is a social construct and man is also a gendered being, right? So they began to question the traditional assumptions regarding women's and men's attributes and their roles, and since the idea of a man was also gendered, therefore, even men began to look at masculinity the same way that women were looking at femininity. And then they developed an area of study called men's studies. And then later in the 1980s and 90s, there was an increasing interest in the rights of gays, lesbians, and the transgender community. And this led to the development of sexuality studies. So therefore, all of these studies combined together, women's studies, men's studies, sexuality or queer studies, formed the basis of gender studies, alright? And although the PhD programs for women's studies have existed since the 1990s, the first PhD program in gender studies began in the US in 2005. And since then, the universities and colleges have begun to expand their curriculum, and many departments have been renamed from women's studies department to the Department of Gender and Women's Studies, or the Department of Gender Studies, which includes women's studies as a major area of study and research. The reason is simple, that the word gender is more inclusive than the word women. Therefore, gender studies is seen to further open up the field of women's studies. But the truth is, it has never been that easy as it sounds, alright? There has been a debate ever since regarding the women versus gender studies. Now, since we are clear about how women's studies emerged out of second wave feminism, and then how gender studies developed as a more inclusive academic discipline than women's studies, I think it will be more easier for us to discuss the key differences between these two disciplines. As we have discussed in great detail about these disciplines that developed over time, so this part is going to be very short and to the point. The major difference between gender studies and women's studies is that gender studies is more inclusive than women's studies. For example, the gender studies includes women's studies as well as men's studies and queer studies, which focuses on the matters relating to gender as well as human sexuality and sexual orientation, with emphasis on the LGBT issues and culture. LGBT stands for the lesbians, gay, bisexual and transgender community. So women's studies, on the other hand, focuses only on women and their issues. Therefore, gender studies becomes more inclusive and broad than women's studies. In simple words, we can say that the scope of gender studies is more broader than women's studies, right? Now, another difference is that women studies arose out of feminist activism, whereas gender studies emerged out of women studies and became more inclusive and broad than women studies. Moreover, in women studies, there is a strong focus on conscious raising of the students. As I have already mentioned, that conscious raising refers to the process of achieving greater awareness, more awareness as of one's own needs of a political or social nature, alright? But in gender studies, conscious raising is not an important aspect as it is in women studies. Now, there is one more thing. Gender studies is interdisciplinary as well as multidisciplinary, because it studies the gendered nature of economics, biology, and various other disciplines. Now, women studies is only interdisciplinary in nature, as it is centered around social sciences and arts and humanities. But let's talk about interdisciplinary versus multidisciplinary first, alright? What are these two terms? They sound very similar to each other. Okay, these both terms are very vaguely defined on the internet, and hence these are used interchangeably most of the times. You will even find these terms to be synonyms of each other in some dictionaries. But there is a slight distinction between these two terms. In a multidisciplinary approach, two or more disciplines are involved, alright? Each of them provides its own viewpoint on a problem from its own perspective. So, in simple words, you can say that multidisciplinary approach involves little interaction or combining across different disciplines. So, a multidisciplinary curriculum is the one in which same topic is studied from the viewpoint of more than one discipline. But in interdisciplinary approach, it combines two or more disciplines to reach to a conclusion, to reach to a solution, or to answer a question. It integrates or combines knowledge, ideas, or methods from different disciplines. In simple words, in multidisciplinary approach, people or professionals from different fields work on their own. They do their researches within the boundaries of their own particular disciplines, all right? They do not integrate it with other disciplines. They share their ideas, their opinions, the answers on the one question that they were trying to answer, or the problem that everyone was working on. They do not necessarily have to mingle with each other. They don't have to, combine each other's ideas or knowledge to form into one. But in interdisciplinary approach, people and professionals from different fields, they can sit together, they can work together to solve a problem or to reach a conclusion, and thus they can combine or integrate their knowledge and ideas to reach a conclusion, or to form an integrated idea, to form a combined knowledge, alright? So in both the approaches, one thing that which is same between the two is that more than one or two disciplines are involved in both the approaches, alright? And gender studies takes a multidisciplinary approach to understand problems faced by different genders, like men, women, LGBTQ individuals in their cultural, social, political settings. Since none of the genders exist in a vacuum, right? They are influenced by their social settings, they are influenced by their cultural environment, they are heavily influenced by their religious backgrounds, their economic position, the political setting that they are living in. So this is how various disciplines come into play to present their research or ideas on the same topic, alright? Sociology can be used to understand how society functions, and then how gender discrimination and gender inequality continues to exist in societies. Anthropology can be used to explain how genders evolved with time. Psychology can be used to understand the human nature and how it perceives sexuality. Biology can be used to explore the biological differences between genders. Remember when we were discussing the differences between sex and gender, where we were talking about how the biological features determine what sex a person belongs to. So we actually explored a bit of biology there to help us understand our concept about how sex differs from gender. So this is how gender studies is multidisciplinary in nature. Now let's talk about another interesting topic called autonomy versus integration debate in gender studies. There's a lot of confusion about this topic, but it's not very difficult to understand. This discussion actually surfaced in the annual conference of National Women Studies Association in 1982, NWSA, alright? The debate was simply about whether or not gender studies or feminist studies should be offered and studied as a separate field, or whether or not it should be merged with other subjects like it was in sociology, arts and humanities, as a part of, social sciences or political science. Now, the main debate was that people who supported the idea of autonomy for gender or women studies believed that feminists should work in isolation, and they should try to focus on their problems. They should remain independent. They should remain, you know, autonomous, and they should focus on their issues rather than merging into other disciplines, because otherwise they would lose their focus, they would lose their attention, the attention required to solve their issues, to solve their problems. See, when a lot of ideas mix at one place, none of them gets the attention that they deserve, alright? There are chances that they will keep conflicting with each other, alright? Due to the limited budget, due to the limited time, and at times due to the limited energy. So the supporters of autonomy for women and gender studies believe that the main idea of gender is a social construct. The issues of women, the issues of gender, the issues of LGBT community, the feminist goals, etc. They all will be compromised if merged with other major disciplines. They all will be steered away from their main goals. On the other hand, the people who were supporting the idea of integration, they believed that integration would help in reaching the people who can actually influence the society. Because other mainstream disciplines are already well established. Their departments are flourishing all over the world with good fundings, and they have influential people who are already working in different fields, who are already there in the system. So to bring about a change in system, it's really important to get help from people who are already in the system. Those who are influential, those who are at the positions of power, alright? So therefore, it's a new discipline and it needs attention. So there is no harm if they merge this discipline with already established disciplines to get the exposure required, to get the attention required. So this was their main argument on why they were supporting the idea of integration. But regardless of what happened in that debate back then, let's see where we stand today in 2020. Women and gender studies has flourished as a separate discipline, as an autonomous department all over the world. And this is the reason why we are studying it today in Pakistan as well, as a separate discipline and as an optional subject in our competitive exams. So I think now is the time when we should end our lecture here. We have already discussed a lot for a day. So let's call it a day. Alright. Inshallah, we will meet in our next lectures. Take care of yourselves, everyone. Allah Hafiz.